blessed and pleasant good morning, my brothers and sisters in Christ, and welcome to a morning prayer brought to you by the Anglican Diocese of Belize. Today is the 11th day of August, Tuesday, the 11th day of August. I do pray you are having a blessed morning where you are, and that you had a wonderful weekend and a great start to the beginning of the week yesterday. We want to thank Reverend Dawson for leading us in morning prayer yesterday. Thank you so much, Reverend. We want to begin this morning with our first song. Let me get myself settled here with my little book. Day by Day is our first hymn this morning. Day by Day. Let's have a listen.
Passing moment, strength I find to meet my trials here. Trusting in my Father's wide bestowment, I've no cause for worry or for fear. He whose heart is kind beyond gives unto each day what it is best. Love in me is part of pain and pleasure, mingling toil with peace and rest.
Help me then in every tribulation, so to trust your promises, O Lord, that I lose not faith's sweet consolation. Offer me within your holy word.
Help me, Lord, when toil and trouble gain, bear to take our Father's hand. One by one, the days, the moments fleet, till I reach the promised land. Till I reach the
Yes, what a wonderful one to start the morning and to wake us up. Let me see if I could get our words here on screen. And then we will begin with our morning prayer for today, August the 11th. And today we celebrate the Feast of St. Clare of Assisi. We begin with our opening sentence. Let the words of my mouth and the meditations of our hearts be acceptable to you, be acceptable in your sight, O Lord, my strength and my Redeemer. Words from Psalm number 19, verse 14. Let's hope that my brain catches up with my eyes very quickly. If you are following along in our Books of Common Prayer on page 34, we begin with the versicle 1. Blessed be the Lord our God, by whose grace we are yet alive. Blessed be his Son, Jesus Christ, by whose rising we are set free. Blessed be the Spirit of God, in whom is our hope and our joy. Our invitatory prayer. Father, we come together in the name of your Son, Jesus Christ, our Redeemer, to offer you our worship, praise, and thanksgiving. To you belong all power and glory. You are the source of all goodness. Let our worship bear witness to your peace and saving power. Through your Spirit, may we ever rejoice in the abiding presence of our risen and ascended Lord. Amen. Our first canticle for this morning is the canticle De Venite, based on Psalm 95, verses 1 through to 8. O come, let us sing out to the Lord. Let us shout in triumph to the rock of our salvation. Let us come before his face with thanksgiving and cry out to him joyfully in psalms. For the Lord is a great God and a great King above all gods. In his hands are the depths of the earth, and the peaks of the mountains are his also. The sea is his, and he made it. His hands molded dry land. Come, let us worship and bow down and kneel before the Lord our Maker. For he himself is our God. We are the people of his pasture and the sheep of his hand. If only you would hear his voice today, for he comes. He comes to judge the earth. He shall judge the world with righteousness and the peoples with his truth. Glory to the Father and to the Son and to the Holy Spirit. As it was in the beginning, it is now and shall be forever. Amen. At this time, we pause to call to mind before Almighty God those things that in thought, word, or deed we would have done that would have been displeasing to him, that would have been unfair to our neighbor, or that would have been unjust to our very selves. For those times and those moments, Lord, we pray to you for the forgiveness of our sins. Together we pray. Have mercy upon us, most merciful Father. In your compassion, forgive us our sins, known and unknown, things done and left undone. And so uphold us by your Spirit, that we may live and serve you in newness of life, to the honor and glory of your name, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Set us free, O God, from the bondage of our sins, and give us the liberty of that abundant life, which you have made known to us in your Son, our Savior, Jesus Christ, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. At this time, we have the psalm, and we have two psalms for this morning, Psalm 97 and Psalm 99, and they will be read for us by Nikki Gomez and Aria Gongora. Let's have a listen.
Psalm 97. The Lord reigns, let the earth be glad. Let the distant shores rejoice. Clouds and thick darkness surround him.
Righteousness and justice are the foundation of his throne.
Fire goes before him
and consumes his foes on every side.
His lightning lights up the world, and earth sees and trembles.
The mountains melt like wax before the Lord.
Before the Lord of all the earth,
the heavens proclaim his righteousness,
and all the people see his glory.
All who worship images are put to shame. Those who boast in idols worship him, all you gods.
Zion hears and rejoices,
and the villages of Judah are glad because of your judgments, O Lord.
For you, O Lord, are the most high over all the earth.
You are exalted far above all gods.
Let those who love the Lord hate evil,
for he guards the lives of his faithful ones
and delivers them from the hand of the wicked.
Light is shed upon the righteous, and joy on the upright in heart. Rejoice in the Lord, you who are righteous,
and praise his holy name.
Psalm 99. The Lord reigns. Let the nations tremble. He sits enthroned between the cherubim. Let the earth shake. Great is the Lord in Zion. He is exalted over all the nations. Let them praise your great and awesome name. He is holy. The King is mighty. He loves justice. You have established equity. In Jacob you have done what is right and just. Exalt the Lord our God and worship at his footstool. He is holy. Moses and Aaron were among his priests. Samuel was among those who called on his name. They called on the Lord and he answered them. He spoke to them from the pillar of cloud. They kept his statutes and the decrees he gave them. O Lord our God, you answered them. You were to Israel a forgiving God, though you punished their misdeeds. Exalt the Lord our God and worship at his holy mountain, for the Lord our God is holy.
We want to thank Nikki Gomez and Aria Gabriel. I made a mistake there for reading for us. I don't know, you know, I have Gabriel written on the paper and I somehow said Gongora, but I think I know why. So we want to thank Nikki Gomez and Aria Gabriel for leading us in the psalm. We continue with our second canticle for this morning, canticle number 13. Here we go. Glory to you, Lord God of our fathers. You are worthy of praise. Glory to you. Glory to you for the radiance of your holy name. We will praise you and highly exalt you forever. Glory to you in the splendor of your temple. On the throne of your majesty, glory to you. Glory to you seated between the cherubim. We will praise you and highly exalt you forever. Glory to you beholding the depths, in the high vaults of heaven, glory to you. Glory to you, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. We will praise you and highly exalt you forever. At this time, we have the reading of our Old Testament lesson, which comes from Judges chapter 13, verses 1 through to 15, and it will be read for us by Miss Jessita Gongora Usher, and that's why I changed Aria's certain name. So let's listen to Miss Jessita Gongora Usher.
The Israelites again did what was evil in the sight of the Lord, and the Lord gave them into the hand of the Philistines for 40 years. There was a certain man of Zorah, the tribe of the Danites, whose name was Manoah. His wife was barren, having borne no children. And the angel of the Lord appeared to the woman and said to her, "Although you are barren, having borne no children, you shall conceive and bear a son. Now be careful not to drink wine or strong drink or to eat anything unclean, for you shall conceive and bear a son. No razor is to come on his head, for the boy shall be a Nazarite to God from birth. It is he who shall begin to deliver Israel from the hand of the Philistines." Then the woman came and told her husband, "A man of God came to me, and his appearance was like that of an angel of God, most awe-inspiring. I did not ask him where he came from, and he did not tell me his name. But he said to me, 'You shall conceive and bear a son. So then drink no wine or strong drink and eat nothing unclean, for the boy shall be a Nazarite to God from birth to the day of his death.' Then Manoah entreated the Lord and said, 'O Lord, I pray, let the man of God whom you sent come to us again and teach us what we are to do concerning the boy who will be born.' God listened to Manoah, and the angel of God came again to the woman as she sat in the field. But her husband Manoah was not with her. So the woman ran quickly and told her husband, 'The man who came to me the other day has appeared to me.' Manoah got up and followed his wife and came to the man and said to him, 'Are you the man who spoke to this woman?' And he said, 'I am.' Then Manoah said, 'Now when your words come true, what is to be the boy's rule of life? What is he to do?' The angel of the Lord said to Manoah, 'Let the woman give heed to all that I said to her. She may not eat of anything that comes from the vine. She is not to drink wine or strong drink or eat any unclean thing. She is to observe everything that I commanded her.' Manoah said to the angel of the Lord, 'Allow us to detain you and prepare a kid for you.' This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God."
Thank you so much, Miss Jessita. If you give me a couple of seconds to get back to the beginning of the reading here. And I know you are familiar with this reading. You might just not know who it's talking about just yet. So the reading from Judges chapter 13, verses 1 through to 15. And it's interesting because this reading is all about the birth of Samson. Well, not the birth, but so much the promise of the birth of Samson. Of course, when we heard the Philistines, it should have given it away that we were indeed talking about Samson. And in verse chapter 1 there of Judges 13, it tells us exactly why the people would need a deliverer and why. Because the Israelites had again done what was evil in the sight of the Lord. And you know what? There seems to be a cycle going on in the life of Israel. Yes, the children of Israel were being disobedient to God. What's the cycle? Sin, bondage, repentance, deliverance from God, blessing, sin again. That's it. So sin, bondage, repentance, deliverance, blessing, sin again. And it's a cycle that the Israelites have been going through. And it seems from generation to generation, God raises up somebody to deliver them. And clearly, every time they sin, every time they are being disobedient to God, God puts them in a state of bondage. And in this particular era, they are now in bondage in the hands of the Philistine. And they are going to be in bondage for 40 years. 40, of course, being another number that seems to be big with God. And this time, from among the Israelites, there was a man from Zorah, from the tribe of the Danites. And his name was Manoah. And Manoah, of course, is the father of Samson. His wife was barren, and so she could not have children. And of course, at the time, not being able to produce an heir for your husband was something that other women would mock you for, and that other men would think was disgraceful. As a man, you don't have an heir. This is no good. So being barren was a hard thing during that time. And so Manoah's wife, who ironically does not have a name, because she's important in the story, but not that important. So Manoah's wife is barren, and she is doing her day. She's going about her daily life, and an angel of the Lord appeared to her and said, "Although you are barren, you shall conceive and bear a son." Now, it's interesting because the angel of the Lord comes in a manner that is similar to all the other birth narratives before and after this point. The women who are going to use by God are generally the wives of someone who is following the teachings of God. Generally, they are following the teachings of God themselves. They have never had a child before, and their barrenness is going to be broken by a blessing directly from God himself with the birth of their child. So this is the similar birth narrative, and you would hear this birth narrative for John. You will hear this birth narrative for Abraham's wife. So it's a similar birth narrative. And the only thing that was different in the case of Mary was that she was not barren. She just had not yet had a child because she was young. So the birth narrative is the same. And it is kind of like God taking away the shame of the woman who is barren by giving her the gift of life, but not just the gift of life in a child, but the gift of life in a child who is going to do big things for God. And so he comes to Manoah's wife. I really wish she had a name. He comes to Manoah's wife and he says to Manoah's wife, even though you are barren, you are going to conceive and bear a son. And the fact that it's an angel lets them know, lets Manoah's wife know that this is not going to be any ordinary child. Yes? And he gives her instructions as to how she should live because the child is chosen even before birth. And so even before birth, this child's life is supposed to be lived in such a way that is going to bring honor and glory to God. And she must not drink strong wine or any strong drink. She's not to eat any unclean food, because the son she is going to bear is not supposed to have any razor come near his head, for this child will be a Nazarite. Now, it's special instructions regarding the child to come even before his birth. And who is a Nazarite? A Nazarite to God. And if you would go and look, and if you have a pen, you could write this down. Numbers chapter 6, verses 1 through to 21 gives us the vows that a Nazarite is supposed to be able to take. They were not supposed to consume any alcohol or strong drink. They were not supposed to eat anything that comes from the vine. So they can't have grapes, which become wine. They can't have raisin. They can't have nothing like this. They are never supposed to cut their hair. No razor is supposed to touch their head. They are not supposed to be around dead bodies or corpse. And if somebody should suddenly die in their presence, they need to offer a special sacrifice, go into fasting for 7 days, and then shave off all the hair on the 8th day to purify themselves and make them clean to start again. And so the Nazarites had very, very strict rules as to how they were supposed to live with God. And you would hear how these trick rules came into play for Samson. And later on, if we continue in the book of Judges, you will hear how he broke all of these rules for a woman. But I tell you, by own a woman as something else, boy. Anyhow, so this woman came after the angel visited her, and she says to her husband, "A man of God came to me, and his appearance was like an angel." And she betrays. She portrays, that's the word, this story to her husband. And she's honest about it to her husband. I didn't ask him where he come from, and he didn't tell me his name. But he tell me that I am going to bear a son. And it could be that in her excitement of hearing that she will have a child, she wasn't even interested in who the man was. She knew in her spirit that he was a man of God, because clearly she addresses him this way when she refers to him to her husband. So clearly she knows he's a man of God. I don't know which part he come from, but I know that he was a special man, and he told me that I will have a son, and he gives me rules. So she remembers the important things. I'm going to have a baby, and these are the rules I'm going to have to live by. And she tells the husband that the baby is going to be a Nazarite from the day of his birth to the day of his death. And we all know that at his death, Samson was still in the presence of God and was still gifted special powers by God in order to fulfill his vows. Then it goes on to tell us that Manoah then does something interesting. Manoah then entreats the Lord. Yes, so he has heard this story from his wife, and it's not that he's doubting, it's just that he wants the news for himself. Yes, and so he entreats and prays to God, saying, let the man of God whom you sent come to us again and teach us what we are supposed to do concerning this boy who will be born. So he's not just concerned to hear the news for himself. He is asking God, you know what, you told my wife how she should live before the birth of this child, but please, God, send back this angel to teach us how we are supposed to raise this child. Clearly, this child is going to be special. We will not be able to do this alone. Send your guidance, please, unto how we are to raise this child. And I have never had a child, but I could imagine as a parent, you prayed when you first look into the eyes of your bouncing baby boy or girl, and you said, oh my gosh, okay, I will need your help in order to raise this child. Not just the help of family around you, but the help of God who gifted you with this child. And every time I think about parenthood, and maybe this is why God has not granted me any children, but I think to myself, 41 years, and I am hardly able to balance and maintain me, much less have the responsibility of balancing and maintaining an entire other separate human life. That's a huge responsibility, B. I can't remember some days if I eat. How would I, you see what I'm saying? And Manoah probably had this same concern. Manoah's thing was, yo, I ain't never had a child before, and this child clearly is special. Please send some instructions. And I could remember my mother saying, sadly, God never give me a manual when uno born. She used to say that because, of course, the first child is different from the second child, is different from the third child. And if only they came with manual that we could actually understand what processes go on in their little minds and even as they grow up. But Manoah was asking God for a manual on how to raise Samson. And it's interesting because Manoah must have been in good standing with God, because God heard and listened to Manoah's prayer, and he sent the angel of God to come back. And the angel came again to the woman. Yeah? Her husband was not with her. So this job is not necessarily Manoah's responsibility fully. It is the woman's job to raise the child. And the angel came back to Manoah's wife, and she runs to get her husband. And then, of course, he is there, and the man, you know, follows. Manoah follows his wife, and the man says to him, you know what? These are the rules. But Manoah does something interesting. First, when he prayed, he simply asked for guidance on how to raise a child. But now he's going to do something. He questions the identity of the man. Are you the man that spoke to my wife, to this woman? And the man says, you know what? Yeah, I am. And Manoah said, when your words come true, what is to be the rule of the boy's life? What is he to do? So Manoah now is not just asking for guidance on how to raise a child. He is pushing his luck, and he's asking for a glimpse into the future. And we know that that's not going to happen. Only God knows the end from the beginning. And so the angel says to Manoah, let the woman take heed to everything I have said to her. Let her do what I have told her to do. I am not going to tell you the future by telling you what's to become of the boy's life and what is he to do. I have told the woman how she must live and how she must raise the boy, and that's it. You have to trust that God will guide you through the process. And it's interesting because a lot of the times we want to ask God what the future holds. He already told us he's going to be with us. He already told us the future is going to be great, but we want the details. You see, we are creatures that need to know. No, you don't need to know. You simply need to know he who knows. You simply need to know he who knows. You don't need to know the future. I don't need to know what will happen tomorrow. I just have to trust that God is going to be there. And so Manoah had that rude awakening from the angel by being told that that's not going to happen. I'm not going to tell you what's going to become of the boy's life. Simply follow the rules I have given for what the wife should eat and how the boy should be raised as a Nazarite. And he repeats the commandments, and then Manoah recognizes where he has slipped up and says, you know what, please stay with us and help us to prepare a meal for you. A kid in this case is not, and I don't like when we call children kid, because kid is a young goat. And so Manoah offers the angel some food, and that is where the reading comes to an end. But it is an interesting story in terms of what is going to happen and this deliverer that God is sending. And the deliverer comes through special announcement. The deliverer comes through a being that is set apart. The deliverer comes with special rules that govern their well-being. And all the deliverers seem to come in this same pattern. And interesting is that through the cycle of Israel's life, this is what God is going to do. And in our life, this is what God did. Man became so sinful that he sent Jesus. And even in our life today, we get out of control. We forget to stick close to God. Something terrible happens to us. Deliverance comes through from God through means of somebody. We go back into a period of joyfulness and obedience. We slip again and it starts all over again. And it's an interesting thing because the reading is all about a set of parents being willing to consecrate their child unto God. And with that, I want to share just a little bit about the life of Claire of Assisi. Now, Claire was born in 1194 and was the daughter of a wealthy family from Assisi. And if Assisi sung famous, it's because when she was 18 years old, she heard a sermon by Francis of Assisi, St. Francis of Assisi, and she was so moved by this sermon that she heard that she decided to follow the example of the Franciscan brothers and vowed herself to a life of poverty. Her family was mortified by this. They took her back from following Francis by force. And one night, in both a tactical and symbolical gesture, she ran away from home. She slipped out of her house through the door of the dead, which is traditionally a small door in a house where they used to carry out corpses. So only corpses used to come out of the house through that door. So she slipped out through that door and returned to the house where the Franciscans were living. She cut off her hair and she joined a convent. Yes? She started, after leaving home this way, much to the dismay of her parents, she started her own order. And she was eventually joined by two of her sisters. And then when her father died, her mother joined her order as well. Yes? And you know what? It's just, she had several of her friends who left their livelihood and came to join her in this life of poverty. You know, and the Franciscan brothers are friars and they became minoresses. So she started her own order. And when she was about 21 or 22, they tried to get her to be the superior and she wouldn't. And all she did was devoted herself in prayer, caring for the sick and works of mercy for the poor and those who were neglected in the society. And it's interesting because we have two contradicting kind of stories here. We have parents in the Bible, in the reading, who willingly gave up their child but wanted instructions, and then the parents of Claire of Assisi, who we celebrate today. whose parents didn't want her to go, but in the end, when her father died, her sister and her mother, her best friend, all these people just joined in and became a part of the movement. And it's all about our willingness to commit our lives to God. That's it. And sometimes when God calls us to commit our lives to Him, the people around us will not support it. Kind of like Francis's family. Claire's family. They might not support it. But if it is God calling us, saying no and running away from it will only last for a little while. And we will eventually have to give in. And believe me, even when we give in, if the people around us are not supportive, it won't last always. There will be a day when they come about. Because the truth is that even the heart that is not willingly giving itself to God cannot deny the will of God. It's that simple. Even if you don't believe in God, He still exists. Even if you don't believe that He created the sun, the moon, the stars, and all the other things in the universe, the sun is still going to rise tomorrow, whether you believe in Him or not. And that is what happened with Claire of Assisi. And I pray that we continue to be able to follow through with Samson's life and see how he will grow up to be committed. And of course, Samson is an Israelite, so guess what's going to happen? Commitment, blessing, sin, bondage, deliverance, all over again. We will stop there for today. We just give God thanks for those who are willing to commit their lives to God and those who continue to serve God, even in the face of trials to the point of having to leave family behind. Amen. We profess our faith in the God who calls us to serve Him in whatever capacity we can by reciting the words of the Apostles' Creed. Get our words back here on screen. Together we profess our faith saying, I believe in God, the Father Almighty, the Creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, His only Son, our Lord. He was conceived by the power of the Holy Spirit and born of the Virgin Mary. He suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day He rose again. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. The Lord be with you. As our Savior has taught us, so let us pray. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. Save us from the time of trial and deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen. Using suffrage A on page 43, if you are following along in your books of common prayer. Lord, reveal your love among us, that we may know the joy of your salvation. Grant peace within and among all nations, and teach our leaders wisdom. Endow your church with faithfulness, and her servants with knowledge and true godliness. Defend, O Lord, the rights of the poor and the oppressed, that your justice may be known among all people. Lord, renew your spirit within us, that in us and through us your will may be done. Our collects for this morning begins with the collect for the 10th Sunday after Pentecost, Proper 14, in our Books of Common Prayer. It can be found on page 177. Let us pray. Grant to us, Lord, we pray, the Spirit to think and do always those things that are right, that we who cannot exist without you may by you be enabled to live according to your will. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever. Amen. I call it for the feast of St. Clare of Assisi. O God, whose blessed Son became poor, that we through his poverty might be rich, deliver us from an inordinate love of this world, that we, inspired by the devotion of your servant Clare, may serve you with singleness of heart and attain to the riches of the age to come. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever. Amen. And this morning I ask your prayers for prisons and correctional institutions. Let us pray. Lord Jesus, for our sake you were condemned as a criminal. Visit our jails and prisons with your pity and judgment. Remember all prisoners and bring the guilty to repentance and amendment of life according to your will, and give them hope for their future. When any are held unjustly, bring them release. Forgive us and teach us to improve our justice. Remember those who work in these institutions. Keep them humane and compassionate, and save them from becoming brutal or callous. And since what we do for those in prison, O Lord, we do for you, constrain us to improve their lot. All this we ask for your mercy's sake. Amen. At this time, we offer our personal intercessions before Almighty God, giving him thanks first and foremost for the life of St. Clare of Assisi and for all those who seek to serve the Lord in various means. We also want to give thanks for those who are celebrating the gift of a new year of life. I know I have not been with you since Saturday, and so on Sunday, my friends Miss Sonia Villafranco celebrated a birthday. On Monday, Miss Becky Serrano, Mr. Dale Westby, Mr. Errol Aranda, Mr. Mike and Matt Nielsen, who are twins that are friends of mine, celebrated birthdays as well yesterday. Miss Marianne Cadle had a birthday, I believe. And then today, Mr. Dominic Walcott, Miss Alda Noble, Miss Felicia Zuniga, Miss Carolyn Pandy, Mr. Lloyd Young, and Miss Donna Arnold are celebrating a birthday. We want to give God thanks for this new gift of life, and we pray his blessing upon you, not only for your birthday, but indeed for all the days ahead. In Jesus' name, amen. We want to give God thanks for those who are recovering from illness or surgery, and we remember in our prayers Miss Judith, Miss Marcy, Miss Monica, Miss Margaret, Miss Ines, Miss Eileen, Miss Sylvia, Miss Harris, Miss Pauline, Miss Des, Miss Janice, Miss Marva, Miss Rose, Miss Jane, Miss Mary, Miss Jill, and Miss Delverine. We remember our brothers, Mr. Hilbert, Mr. Rudolph, and Mr. Normando, Mr. Cecil, Mr. Larry, and Mr. Finley, Mr. Rupert, Mr. Linsford, and Mr. Kennett, Mr. James, Mr. Michael Samuels, and Mr. Mike Soberanis, Mr. Alfred, Young Jordan, Emery, Norman, Aaron, and we ask God's continual prayers and blessing upon you. We pray for those who are caregivers, and we remember Miss Monica and Miss Sonia this morning. We pray for comfort for those who mourn. You would have heard this morning that I didn't mention Miss Hedy Anderson this morning in our prayers for continual healing. Unfortunately, Miss Hedy passed away yesterday, and we pray for Miss Marva and the rest of her family. We continue to pray for comfort for the family of Miss Glenda Langsworth, Mr. Kenneth Christian, for the Sanders family, for the family of Miss Charlotte Neal and her family, and indeed for all those who mourn the loss of a loved one. We pray that God will grant you comfort and peace during this time of bereavement, and that he will grant eternal rest to those who would have died. We continue to pray for protection for our loved ones who are far away from us. We remember our students, Tammy, Anwa, Karina, Ashley, and Courtney. We pray for wayfarers at sea. We pray for persons in the various forms of quarantine, persons stuck in countries not their own due to the closure of borders. We pray for our loved ones in the military overseas, praying for Jade and Emil. We pray for the enablement and protection of all medical professionals in the performance of, in the performance of their duties. We remember Dr. Molina, Nurse Gill, Nurse Merlin, Nurse Alejandra, and Nurse Aaron at this time. We pray for our frontline workers throughout the world, especially those here at home. We pray for healing for our frontline workers who are infected by COVID-19, for all persons who are infected by COVID-19. We pray for their healing. We pray for a cure or a vaccine for this disease. We pray for the containment and eventual elimination of this disease. We pray that we all come to recognize that we must do our part to help to slow the curve or to flatten the curve of the spread of this illness. We pray for the combating of the economic fallout caused by this pandemic. We pray for those industries most hard hit by this pandemic, the tourism, service and hospitality industry, the aviation and transportation industry. And indeed, we pray and remember all persons who would have found themselves in financial constraints because of this pandemic. We continue to remember the most vulnerable in our society, the poor, the needy, the elderly, those with pre-existing health conditions. We continue to pray for our security forces as they have the responsibility of enacting the laws that govern us. We pray for those in government, in positions of public authority and trust, who are called to make the rules that will govern us. We pray for the churches and the church leaders as they continue to guide us spiritually. We continue to pray for those in the private sector and those in non-governmental organizations who continue to do their part and are involved in the fight against COVID-19. We continue to remember persons who suffer both in the national and international community as a result of COVID-19. We remember those persons who are suffering as an effect due to the effects of natural disasters, hurricanes, flooding, earthquakes. We continue to pray for the people in Beirut. We continue to pray really for people all over the world in their various lots, praying that God will meet them at the point of their needs and continue to provide and protect them in all things. For the prayers of our hearts that our tongues cannot confess, we pray that Almighty God would hear our prayers. We conclude our intercessions by praying together. Almighty and eternal God, sanctify and govern our hearts and bodies in the ways of your law and the works of your commandments, that under your protection now and ever we may be preserved in body and soul through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. By means of announcement, I want to thank you, brothers and sisters, for joining us for morning prayer this morning. I want to thank again those who participated, and I remind you of our services for today: noonday devotions, followed by children's Bible minutes at 2:30, evening prayer at 4, and then of course we have comp line at 9 p.m. We want to thank the Bishop and Mrs. Wright and all who were a part of the service on Sunday, reminding us of Diocesan Day and the pride that we should feel, and the work we have in continuing to support the work of our diocese. I want to thank you for supporting us in these ministries. I know that many of us were probably thrown for a loop when we had the closure of churches, but know that we are doing this for your protection and our own protection. And it might be a little inconvenient again, but you know what? It is safer for us to be, you know what? How this goes? Prevention is better than cure. Precisely. So we want to thank you for understanding. We do pray you have a blessed and beautiful day. We conclude by saying our prayer of dedication as well as the grace, followed by our final hymn. Let us pray. Almighty God, we thank you for the gift of your holy word. May it be a lantern to our feet, a light to our paths, and a strength to our lives. Take us and use us to love and to serve all persons in the power of the Holy Spirit and in the name of your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. And now, beloved, may the grace of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with us all, now and evermore. Amen. The Lord be with you. Let us bless the Lord. Thanks be to God. Our closing hymn, Come to Us, Creative Spirit. May God's Spirit guide you throughout your day and indeed throughout this week. I look forward to seeing you again tomorrow morning for another edition of Morning Prayer. Until then, stay home if you can. Stay as safe as you possibly can. Do not forget that God loves you. Until next time, bye for now.